So lovely to see those of you who are in church, and this service is still being recorded, so if some of you come to watch it later on, it's great that you're doing that, and I hope you'll be able to really enter into this service. All our hymns today, we're going to sing from songs of praise, so we'll have a bit more beef in the background to sing along to, but you can either look at the screen or you can follow in the hymn books, whichever is your preference. And they're golden oldies. Oh, no, two are golden oldies and one is slightly golden newy. All right. It says in Acts somewhere that the disciples were coming up into a storm and they were rowing hard because the wind was against them. Do you know what? I feel the winds against me at the moment, so I'll need you to kind of calm the winds and encourage and strengthen me this morning. And I hope if you're feeling the winds are against you today, well, they'll also subside a bit, at least for the duration of this service, and we can come into the Lord's presence. My wife, who is here today, has asked me to remind you to that there is a sale of ladies' goods, sorry gentlemen, in the church centre on this coming Saturday, which reminds me of the old thing. It was a sort of ladies, bring your unwanted items, bring your husbands too. and also a little sad thing, Viola made a very nice big banner to go up on where the Flower Festival banner goes to, and some naughty person ripped it down on Sunday evening, so I don't know if they've got a thing against, so you can see a tattered Ukraine banner at the back that she made. Anyway, that's a little thing. So you should have an order of service, and so let's begin. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. This is the day the Lord has made. Let's rejoice. And we sing together, say together, we have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive his holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek his forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we may give ourselves to the service of God. So let's first of all offer our praise and thanksgiving in song and call to one another in the words of the old 100th, All People That on Earth Do Dwell, which is number 1313.
Thank you.
Such great words taken, of course, from Psalm 100. So now we've done some praising and thanksgiving, and now we're going to seek God's forgiveness of our sins. Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So let's now, in this moment, turn away from our sin, our weaknesses, our frailties, and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith together. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore to us the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so may the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we can say, "Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song will we praise our God." We're going to have our first reading now, which Viola's going to come and read to us. And it's the last chapter of Acts, and Paul has come to the last of his known journeys to us, a prisoner on his way to Rome.
Paul's arrival in Rome. After 3 months, we put out to sea in a ship that had wintered in the island. It was an Alexandrian ship with the figurehead of the twin gods, Castor and Pollux. We put in at Syracuse and stayed there 3 days. From there, we set sail and arrived at Rhegium. The next day, the south wind came up, and on the following day, we reached Puteoli. And there we found some brothers and sisters who invited us to spend a week with them. And so we came to Rome. The brothers and sisters there had heard that we were coming, and they traveled as far as the Forum of Appius and the three taverns to meet us. At the sight of these people, Paul thanked God and was encouraged. When we got to Rome, Paul was allowed to live by himself with a soldier to guard him. 3 days later, he called together the local Jewish leaders. When they had assembled, Paul said to them, "My brothers, although I have done nothing against our people or against the customs of our ancestors, I was arrested in Jerusalem and handed over to the Romans. They examined me and wanted to release me because I was not guilty of any crime deserving death. The Jews objected, so I was compelled to make an appeal to Caesar. I certainly did not intend to bring any charge against my own people. For this reason, I have asked to see you and talk with you. It is because of the hope of Israel that I'm bound with this chain." They replied, "We have not received any letters from Judea concerning you, and none of our people who have come from there has reported or said anything bad about you. But we wanted to hear what your views are, for we know that people everywhere are talking about this sect." They arranged to meet Paul on a certain day and came in even larger numbers to the place where he was staying. He witnessed to them from morning till evening, explaining about the kingdom of God, and from the law of Moses and from the prophets, he tried to persuade them about Jesus. Some were convinced by what he said, but others would not believe. For 2 whole years, Paul stayed there in his own rented house and welcomed all who came to see him. He proclaimed the kingdom of God and taught about the Lord Jesus Christ, all with boldness and without hindrance. This is the word of the Lord.
What a lovely chapter that is, isn't it? Full of lovely little details, some of which we'll come to later. So we're going to sing our second hymn now, and thinking of all the trials and tribulations that Paul had, a bit like Pilgrim in Pilgrim's Progress, which Penny Foe is doing a course with at the moment on Monday afternoons. We're going to sing a hymn by John Bunyan that Paul, if he'd known it, would have sung it with all his heart. He who would valiant be against all disaster. 174. Our second reading, which is part of the lectionary for last Sunday, because that first one wasn't, is from the opening verses of Philemon, when Paul, at a later stage, is back in another prison or in Rome.
From the letter to Philemon, verses 1 to 7. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and fellow worker, also to Appia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your home. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your love for all his holy people and your faith in the Lord Jesus. I pray that your partnership with us in the faith may be effective in deepening your understanding of every good thing we share for the sake of Christ. Your love has given me great joy and encouragement, because you, brother, have refreshed the hearts of the Lord's people. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, once again, we thank you for your word, which can do so much to nourish and encourage us and teach us and challenge us. And we pray now that as I open up these scriptures a little bit, our hearts may be warmed within us and we may go from here encouraged and inspired and challenged. Amen. So if you've been coming on Sunday mornings, you'll know that throughout the summer holidays, we've been following the key points in the life of Paul. Cruising around the Mediterranean, we called it, and some of you will have done that, I guess. And last Sunday, we reached the last part when eventually Paul gets to Rome as a prisoner, the chapter we've just read. And I've chosen to revisit that, and I'm sorry if you were here on Sunday and heard a bit of this, but you're getting some more, and it'll be a slightly different take. And then the second reading, as I said, was one of the lectionary readings for Sunday. Now, that's two readings from the epistles, which you're not supposed to do, really. If you're going to have two readings, one should be from the Old Testament or the Gospel and the Epistle. So I hope none of you are going to report me to the liturgy police or the bishop. I've called this story, this talk, The Never-Ending Story. The Never-Ending Story, which Claire picked up a little bit on Sunday. And my first part of the talk is going to be a very quick retelling, wait for it, of the last 10 chapters of Acts. It will be very quick. It's a period that covers 5 to 6 years, but in one sense it's all one phase in his life. Though at the start of it, I don't suppose Paul would have known or thought or guessed that this was going to be 5 or 6 years. So, in Acts chapter 19... Paul is living and working, teaching and preaching in Ephesus, part of Turkey. That's chapter 19. And at the end of that, he decides to go to Jerusalem and then on to Rome. He's never been to Rome before. So before he does that, he does a little bit of tour of Greece to chivvy along and cheer up all the churches he's founded there. And then having done that, he starts his journey to Jerusalem properly. He sails back close to Ephesus and gets a message to the elders, I can't stop in Ephesus, but come and see me, come and see me. And then when he gets there, he talks to them, and then he says, now you're never going to see me again. So they're all sad about that, and they're weeping. He says, I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are awaiting me. Wow. He knows that, but he's keeping going. So in Acts 10, 21, on his way to Jerusalem, he goes to the islands of Kos, expect somebody's been there, Rhodes and Cyprus, and then onto the Syrian coast. And at his first stopping place on the coast of Syria, he meets and prays with the Christians, and Luke records, interesting this, through the Spirit, they urged him not to go to Jerusalem. But the Spirit's told Paul to go to Jerusalem. Through the Spirit. Interesting, that, isn't it? And he ignores that warning from them. And then he gets to a place called Caesarea, which is like the Roman capital of Palestine. And again, he's warned by a prophet there that if you go up to Jerusalem, you're going to be arrested and handed over. And Luke writes, when we heard this, we and the people pleaded with Paul not to go up to Jerusalem. Then Paul answered, why are you weeping and breaking my heart? I'm ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. And when he would not be dissuaded, Luke says, we gave up and said, the Lord's will be done. Acts 21, he arrives in Jerusalem. He's warmly received. He goes to purify himself in the temple to show that he's still maintaining part of his Jewishness. But then a rumor spreads that he's brought Gentile Greeks right into the heart of the temple. And when a rumor spreads, Paul is seized, a riot breaks out, he's being beaten up until the soldiers come galloping in, or walking in, marching in, to save him from this angry mob. And Paul, rather than say, oh, thank goodness for that, get me out of here, he says to the centurion, excuse me a minute, do you think I could just address the crowd? So he then, that's chapter 22, he then gives them a sermon, and he's got the Roman soldiers either side of them, so they're all quiet for a while, until he gets to mentions the Greeks, and then they all go mad again, and there's a riot, and the soldiers have to rush him away. And the commander is obviously fed up with him, saying, well, I don't know what this is, I'll give him a jolly good flogging. And Luke writes, I love some of the details of Luke, as he says, as they stretched him out. You can see it, can't you? Right, okay, get your tunic off, get your back clear, hold on to him, guys. Then Paul says, is it legal to flog a Roman citizen who's not been found guilty of anything, nor tried by anyone? Commander gets a bit worried at that, so he stops. Acts 23, he appears before the Roman commander and the senior Jews to give his defense. Once again, he preaches to them, and then there's another uproar, so they have to whisk him out of the court. That night in a cell, an angel comes to him and says, don't worry, you've testified about me in Jerusalem, you're going to go to do it in Rome also. Then Acts 23, Paul's nephew overhears a plot to kill Paul. He tells it to Paul. Paul tells it to the commander of the prison. The commander of the prison tells it further up the chain. So they think, we can't have this. So we've got to secret him out and get him away from Jerusalem down to Caesarea, like the Roman HQ. And they do that. And they do it with a guard of 500 soldiers to escort Paul down to Caesarea. When the senior Jews hear this, they all gallop down to try and have another trial there, and in the presence of Felix, who's the overall Roman governor, like successor to Pontius Pilate. And they do that, and then Felix, he forgets about it. And Paul is 2 years in Caesarea in prison, because the man at the top can't be bothered to deal with it. Just lay it there. I wonder what Paul was thinking all that time, 2 years in Caesarea prison. Then a new governor arrives. Some more Jews come down to try to persuade him to do something about Paul. But Festus is called Festus. And Festus then says, probably he doesn't want it on his side. Oh, you appealed to Caesar, did you? Well, to Caesar you will go. Then the king, successor to Herod, Agrippa, comes. And Festus and Agrippa listen to what Paul's got to say. And he gives his testimony on the Damascus Road, preaches to them. Festus says, you're mad. Agrippa says, in the King James Version, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. Lovely phrase, that King James Bible. Anyway, that doesn't happen. And at last, Paul leaves Caesarea on the ship. They go along the coast a bit. They get to Crete. It's getting near winter. Paul says, don't go. They need to make it. They're trying to make a quick dash for Rome. And then chapter 27 is that wonderful, wonderful account of the storm ending up with him being shipwrecked on the Isle of Cyprus. And some of you might have been to St. Paul's Bay, where it may be that he was shipwrecked up. All 276 were saved. They're there 3 months now to see out the winter. And then finally, they make their way to Rome, and that's the reading we had in Acts chapter 28. You noticed, did you, that when Paul is on his way to Rome, he had a drink of beer to get there? Did you notice that in the reading? Acts 28:15 says, when the brethren heard of us, they came to meet us as far as the three taverns. And when Paul saw them, he thanked God and took a pint of courage. Well, I added a pint, but the scripture says he's at the three taverns, he took courage. So, and then what? He gets to Rome and he's under house arrest for 2 years. This is about 5 or 6 years from when he says, I need to go to Jerusalem and then on to Rome. It's a fantastic story, isn't it? But This is not in Acts. We do know that after he was eventually released, he was eventually released after two or more years, and he then went traveling again, possibly to Spain, before he ends back up again in Rome, and then probably during the persecution of Nero, arrested and executed. But during that second imprisonment, he wrote some of his letters, including the one to the wealthy Christian Philemon. Okay, three lessons to learn. If we can learn from that, that Paul never lost an opportunity to tell the story of Jesus Christ, whether it was to an angry mob in Jerusalem, whether it was to the guards in his prison cell. Those poor guards, they must have had to hear from Paul day in, day out. What were they doing about their souls and where they're going to be saved, weren't they? So he would be doing it to them, just as he did to the jailer in Philippi when they got released out of that. Whether it was from the King Agrippa or the Roman commanders, whether it was to the men on the ship, whatever. He was always witnessing to Christ and trying to build up and encourage others if they were of the faith or bring them to the faith. 4 years out of those five, he was in prison or under house arrest. Did that stop him? No. Speaking to everyone, writing letters, encouraging all who came to see him and visited him. Did his spirits flag? Well, I expect they did sometimes, and we can tell that from some of the letters. Did he sometimes wonder why he was stuck like that, and that his case didn't come to court and was stuck in Caesarea? Probably he did wonder that. Did he give up? No. Look at his message to Philemon. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and from Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend, our fellow worker, and also to Apphia, our sister, and Archibus, our fellow soldier together, and to the church that meets in your home. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus. I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your love for all his holy people and your faith in the Lord Jesus. I wonder if somebody took a message to, if one of you, dies next week and you go to heaven and you meet Paul, would you tell him about the love for all his people and the faith in the Lord Jesus of the All Saints congregation there in Weston? Is that what Paul might hear about us from others? Hope so. Some of us are increasingly our world is shrinking, isn't it? We're more confined to home and whatever, etc., etc. Not as much as Paul in prison. And here he is doing three or four things in prison, telling the story that we can all do. He's writing lots of letters and sending messages out to encouragement. There's not a person here can't do that. Little note. A little card, a little phone call, a little email. That's what Paul was doing. And praying. So in this opening Philemon, I'm always giving thanks to you for what I hear about you. It's prayer of thankfulness to God as messages were brought in of these growing churches still standing firm and what individuals are doing. But he's also praying for them. I pray that your partnership may be effective in deepening your understanding. He's praying for the churches that he's known, the individuals that he's known. And maybe we're not so keen on this last one. He's giving plenty of advice, as he did to Philemon, all about take your slave back, won't you, and to other churches, giving them advice and good counsel. So Paul is always never losing an opportunity to tell the story. Secondly, We don't have the full story, the full picture of our faith, but we have enough of the story. We don't have the full story about Paul and exactly what happened to him. Luke just ends his historical thing there. He says, after 2 years, and we all want to say, well, what happens next? Well, we don't know for sure. We can piece together a little bit, as I say, from the epistles, but Luke just stops there. It's a bit of a cliffhanger, really. And we don't have all the letters that Paul wrote. Some of them are missing, or other apostles. We certainly don't have the full story and full knowledge of all there is to know about God and faith, etc. We don't probably have the full story about ourselves or the lives and makeups of other people. But we do have enough of the story, enough of the, in the scriptures, in the experience of others, in our own testimony, we do have enough to build our lives and to go forward. And as Paul prayed for Philemon and the church there, to deepen our understanding. And of course, to grow in love for one another and faithfulness, faith in the Lord Jesus. We don't have the full story, but we have enough of the story in so many different ways. So much more than those early Christians had. And my last one about this great story, it never ends. The story of faith and the church and our own story never ends. I mean, at the end of chapter 28, it ends there, but we know he went on to do a lot more. It didn't end for him at the end of his life, because he enters into a new life. There is no end to the story for the church, well, I guess until Christ returns. It didn't end when all the apostles and all those people who literally saw Jesus died. It didn't end there. It's continued on down these centuries. And our story will never end. There's more to come. Hopefully a lot of it good. Some of it a bit of a trial like Paul had. And there's more to come after the body has taken its last breath. Let me end with what is, as it were, almost the last known earthly words spoken by Paul. So it's in the scriptures, it's almost the last that we hear from him. But of course, as I've just said, his story never ends. But it's a lovely way. It comes from the second letter of Timothy, which is the last letter that we have that Paul wrote from prison. And he is pretty exhausted now. He's probably not 60, but he's an old man by then. He says this. Timothy, a young man, of course, such a good companion to him. Timothy, I'm already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. I've fought the good fight. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith. And now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Not just to Paul, but for us all, who've put our hope and trust and confidence in that same Lord Jesus Christ. We have a story to tell. We're part of a big story. The story of faith will never end. Our story will never end. Thank God. Let's just pray. Father, we thank you that you let us catch a glimpse of your wonderful story of redemption and Jesus coming to the world and a purpose for our lives in our lives. Help us, Lord, to hold on to that story, to keep the faith, and to be brave and bold and loving enough to retell the story whenever, wherever, to whomsoever we can. And may this church, Lord, we pray, especially as Tom Iacomeni comes, may we be a church that tells the story, the old, old story, and through the retelling and the living out of that story, others may be drawn to you. This we pray in your name. Amen. So now we're going to declare our faith, and we'll, if you're able to stand, want to stand, do stand, but if you're going to sit there, that's fine. And we'll say the creed together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. So let's turn to prayer now. And first of all, we pray for the church and for its leaders. We pray especially for our own new rector-to-be, Tom Iacomeni, and his wife, Mims. We pray, Lord, that you will be preparing him and enabling him and gifting him to lead this church and Norstoke and Langridge into the next phase, however long that is. Lord, too, we pray for the new Bishop of Bath and Wells as he arrives this autumn, facing the challenge that so much dioceses face and the Church of England face in these challenging times. We pray that you'll bless him, and may he be an inspiration, an encouragement, and a leader in this part of the world. And we pray for, back to our church, for all those who play any leadership role in your church, whether it be the wardens, or the PCC, or the readers, or those who head up different rotas and groups. Thank you for their service, Lord. Bless that service, we pray. And bless them because of their service. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, our own church faces challenges, but when we look at the nation and the nations of the world, at this particular moment, it all seems so dire and so concerning, whether it be the economy, the war in Ukraine and elsewhere, the natural disasters, the emergence of totalitarian states, and our own frailties and ups and downs of politics here. Thank you, first of all, that our citizenship is not first and foremost for the United Kingdom. Our citizenship is in heaven. But nevertheless, we pray for our country. We pray for our new Prime Minister, Liz Truss, for the new cabinet that will be announced later today and tomorrow. Lord, we pray that they will govern wisely. Wisely and well. And especially that they may govern in truthfulness and honesty and integrity. And we pray for the conflicts and the leaders of the world. We pray that you will especially somehow bring to an end that conflict in Ukraine. Lord, we've prayed this for many months now. We continue to ask you to overrule the forces of evil that are at work and bring about peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks and pray for our community here in Weston, thanking you that despite all that's going on in the world, this is a good place to be in. Thank you for the lovely atmosphere at the flower show on Saturday and the many people who contributed and enjoyed it, and for the many, many other activities that are undertaken, whether led by the church or not led by the church. We pray for a spirit of peace and good neighbourliness to be continue to be in our parish and in Weston. Lord, in your mercy, Hear our prayer. And Father, we bring now before you people known to us, people in our newsletter who are in distress or ill or facing great problems. Think especially of Rob Gray, our treasurer, whose father died suddenly, whose funeral is this week. We think of Emma Miles facing, and her three children facing homelessness. Pray for the efforts of those in the church who are trying to work with her to find a solution. We pray for those on our prayer list who need your prayers, recovering from illness, facing illness. And Lord, we give you thanks for the good news we've heard this week of Miranda, the young woman who's had very severe breast cancer, and for the very good news that's come this week. Thank you for that. And now we ask the Lord's steadfast love and mercy to be with people known to us. Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. And we'll end with a collect for last Sunday and then the Lord's Prayer. So we'll say together the collect, which will be on the screen, a short one. Say together, God of constant mercy, who sent your Son to save us, remind us of your goodness. Increase your grace within us, that our thankfulness may grow, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And gathering our prayers and praises and thankfulness into one, as our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And we'll sing a going out hymn, Will You Come and Follow Me? That's the slightly more modern one. And it's number 1120 in this hymn books. 1120 if you want to follow it there. Thank you. company I'll go, where your love and footsteps show. So a final prayer. So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us and with those we love and care for always. Amen. Go in love, in peace, to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen.